So this is our 21st Flow Seminar. My name is Samuel Horvath, and together with Petr Richtarik, Virginia Smith, Aurelien Belet, and Dan Alistars, we are the organizer of Flow Seminar. For those of you who are attending for the first time, Flow Seminar stands for Federated Learning One World Seminar, and it was created as a global online forum for the dissemination of the latest scientific research in all aspects of federated learning. This includes both theory and application in areas such as distributed optimization, learning algorithms, privacy, cryptography, personalization systems, hardware, and many more. For today's talk, it's my great pleasure to introduce our speaker, Yassin Lakhel. Yassin is a second year PhD student at Laboratoire Jean Kunzmann, advised by Jérôme Manik. Before that, he graduated from NCMAC and University Grenoble Alpes in Applied Mathematics and Computer Science with a focus on optimization, machine learning, and probability theory. His research interests include optimization problems involving uncertainty and their application in stochastic programming and machine learning. And today he's going to talk about his recent work on device heterogeneity in federated learning. So Yassin, stage is yours.
Thank you, Samuel, for the introduction. And I want to thank also the organizer for the initiative and making possible this seminar. All right, so this is a joint work with my PhD advisor, Jérôme Malik here, and my two friends and colleagues from Seattle, Krishna Pilutla and David Harshery. All right, so as most of the previous talks did, I will present quickly what is federated learning, the challenges that we are tackling before announcing the plan of our work. So in federated learning, a number of client devices with privacy-sensitive data collaborate to learn a machine learning model. And to do so, the devices communicate with a central server while keeping their data decentralized. And a typical round of communication starts as follows. The server selects a subfleet of devices toward which it sends its model. This can be, for instance, a linear model or a neural network. Then, each device updates the received model based on their local data distribution. And finally, the server performs a secure aggregation of the updated models. Typically, it averages them, and that completes one round of communication. And we iterate over this round of communication up to convergence to a single model that is meant to satisfy the whole set of devices. So this framework brings many challenges related to privacy preservation that can still be an issue, statistical heterogeneity between the devices, system heterogeneity between the devices, or communication costs. But you are going to focus on a particular one, which is the statistical heterogeneity. Our goal is to improve the performance of a model on statistical heterogeneous frameworks without harming the benefits of the existing method with respect to other challenges. All right, so there are basically two ways statistical heterogeneity can harm a federated learning setting. First, from an optimization perspective, it is not easy to ensure the convergence properties in this framework because the local updates performed by the users may deviate the model towards local optimal solutions. That's what is called client drift. And there are already a few methods tackling this issue by basically correcting the drift. And the second obstacle of statistical heterogeneity is that even when actually we have convergence to an optimal solution, we don't know how much the solution is going to be satisfying for this population of devices. Take, for instance, the task of next word prediction on mobile phones, and assume that we deploy a federated learning framework to learn this task. At the end of the training, we get a model that hopefully will work, but this model might get close to the way some user text on their phones and less close to the way other user text. And then we have to make a choice. Do we want with this service to satisfy the average user as much as possible? Or do we want to guarantee for everyone a minimum level of service? And that's a problem we can face in FedAverage, the standard baseline in federated learning. The goal is to minimize a weighted sum of losses where each FI capture the performance of a given model W with respect to the device I. And in practice, we take the expectation of a loss little f that depends both on the model W and on the random variable xi. And we assume that for each device I, xi will follow distribution qi that is generated by this device. And the weight alpha I can be set in different ways. We can, for instance, take alpha I equal to 1 over n, where n is the number of devices, or alpha I proportional to the number of local data points at the device I. In any case, we are basically trying to minimize the expectation with respect to a distribution that I'm going to call, that I'm going to denote first, P alpha, and that I will call the trend distribution. So P alpha is a mixture of the distributions QI of the training devices with weights alpha I. It is meant to capture the average distribution of the training devices. And at the end of the day, for any test device that comes with a data distribution that is close to P alpha, we can expect good performance on the obtained model. But what can you say about testing devices with distributions that largely depart from this training distribution? It is actually possible that the solution that is output by Fed average might be non-satisfying for an important proportion of users that do not conform to this trend distribution. So the framework that I will present in this talk is targeting this particular problem, taking better into account those devices that significantly depart from the trend distribution. And what we propose is to replace the expectation over the trend distribution in Fed average by a family of functionals that are meant to better capture models for non-conforming users. This family will depend on a parameter theta that is going to help to measure how conformous devices are from the trend distribution, P alpha. Theta will be a parameter between 0 and 1, and setting theta close to 1 will mean that we are focusing for the most part on training devices that are very conformous to the trend distribution. At the opposite, setting theta close to 0 will mean that the model that we are targeting should be the best one for the least conforming users. All right, so here is an outline of the talk. First, I will precisely define the way we measure conformity among users and present the central notion of superquantile in our framework. Second, I will propose a way to handle this framework with a theoretical analysis in the convex case and a practical implementation. And lastly, I will present a few numerical experiments. Is there any questions so far?
So I don't see any question.
Yeah. Okay.
Please continue.
All right, so let's start with the formal definition of the framework. So at the training stage, we assume to have access to M training devices. And each device, I, is characterized by a distribution QI over some data space and the weight alpha I, such that the alpha I are summing to 1. And we keep the notation P alpha for the convex combination of the distributions that captures the trend among these training distributions. And for the rest of this talk, we will look at the distribution of testing devices as convex combination of, or mixture of the distribution or of training devices. That is, for any given test devices, there will be a vector pi, such that the component of pi sum to 1, and such that the data distribution of the testing device is a weighted sum of the training distribution with the weight pi I. This is a reasonable assumption when the population of device available at the training time is a good representation of possible distributions. And it is likely to occur when we dispose of an important number of training devices. And we are going to define the conformity of a given test device as follows. So if pi denotes the associated vector of weight, the conformity of the distribution p pi is going to be the minimum over I of the fractions alpha I over pi. All right, so since both alpha I and pi sums to 1 and are non-negative coefficients, this number will always be between 0 and 1. It is equal to 1. If it is equal to 1, since again, both vectors are summing to one, that means that pi is exactly equal to the trend distribution p alpha. In other words, this distribution follows the trend distribution given by the training devices. If at the contrary, the conformity is close to zero, it means that the testing devices have a data distribution that departs largely from the training distribution. And I'm going to make this a little bit more precise in a few minutes. All right, so given this definition of conformity, we can now formally state our framework. So we call this framework SimpliCLFL. You read here the big delta as SimpliCL, and it is a reference of this modeling assumption that any test device is going to have a distribution that is a mixture or convex combination of the training distributions. So in SimpliCLFL, we propose to minimize the loss f theta, defined here. F theta is the maximum of the expected loss for distribution that belong to a set of distribution big P of theta, parameterized by theta. So this set of distributions consists in all data distributions that admit a conformity level of at least theta. Hence, when theta is close to one, we consider only distributions that depart a little bit from the base, from the trend distribution. And when theta gets closed to zero, we allow ourselves to consider a much bigger set of distribution. So let us note also that in SimpliCLFL, the objective is a max function. So all in all, we are trying to solve a robust optimization problem. So this objective function is actually called the super quantile loss. And more generally, for any discrete random variable u, taking the values ui with probability alpha I, the super quantile turns out to be the supremum of weighted sums of the values of u for weights satisfying these two constraints. First, belonging to the simplex, and second, satisfying this box constraint. The super quantile is known under different names. It is also called the conditional value at risk, the average value at risk, the tail value at risk, or the expected shortfall. So in our case, the variable u will be precisely the random variable that takes n values, which are the expected loss of the n client devices. So the index k here is actually random, and it takes the values I with probability alpha I. Hence, what we are minimizing in SimpliCLFL is the super quantile of this random loss. So let us see a little bit more geometrically how this goes. And let's assume for now that we work with only three training devices whose respective distributions are symbolized by the three extreme points of the simplex. Let us also assume that here, alpha gives an equal weight to the three training users. It can be represented at the center of the simplex. Then, any mixture distribution of this 3-1 can be represented as a point in the simplex. And our superquantile objective writes then as follows. It is again the supremum over weights that satisfy both the simplex constraints in yellow and the box constraints in blue. And thus, we evaluate the worst case loss for testing distribution that lie exactly in this red intersection of the two sets. Now the conformity level theta here is actually related to the radius of this blue box. It is exactly the minimum over I of alpha I over theta. And now we understand that as theta grows up to one, R is going to shrink, so that the intersection with the simplex will be reduced to the trend distribution. And the superquantile parameter here, the superquantile loss boils down then to a fed average objective. At the opposite, when the conformity level gets close to zero, the radius of our blue ball grows and you allow yourself to consider much more mixture of distributions. And the one that achieves the supremum here is going to be exactly the one that puts all its weights on the highest losses. And we can actually characterize in general the worst case reweighting pi that the superquantile achieves with a supremum term here. So indeed, if I denote U again, this random variable that equals the expected loss of device I with probability alpha I, then it's a discrete random variable and its quantiles are exactly the sequence of value that U takes sorted in the increasing order. So we can draw the cumulative distribution of U, which takes as an input a real number T and output the probability of U being less or equal than T. And you can have the quantile function basically by inverting this cumulative distribution function. It is a function from the interval 0, 1 to R. And if we fix a conformity level theta between 0 and 1, the weights that are going to achieve the supremum for this random variable are exactly the one that are going to concentrate on the red part of this graph, the highest losses. So we get the following formula. The superquantile with conformity theta, a level theta, is exactly this, an average of the p quantiles of U with p that is greater than 1 minus theta. So this red part is the one that we are focusing on in our superquantile loss. And again, when theta gets close to 1, the whole distribution is going to be considered. And we get the expectation of U. When theta gets close to 0, we are going to focus on the maximum value of U. And any level and any value of theta enables us to interpolate between these two extremes, that is to focus on a portion of the worst values taken by U. So again, in our case, U takes its values among the distribution of local loss over the training devices. So we are minimizing this function f theta. So when minimizing this function f theta, we are actually focusing on the tail of this distribution of losses over the training users. Okay, so a final duality result about superquantile, which is due to Rockefeller, write the superquantile as the optimal value of a one-dimensional problem. Specifically, the superquantile of U with conformity level theta is going to be exactly the infimum over eta of eta plus 1 over theta, the expectation of this max term. And actually, the optimal solution of this problem is going to be a quantile of the distribution of U. It is exactly the p quantile of U with p equal to 1 minus theta. And if we go back to our problem, we get a new formulation for Simplice LFL as a joint minimization problem. We need to optimize this quantity over both W and eta. All right, so are there any questions at this point?
It doesn't seem any question, I think it was clear. Yeah.
Okay, cool. So let's look at the first toy problem. Assume first that we are working in a centralized setting where we gather data from two different users with two separate distributions. The data in blue comes from the first user and is predominant in this training dataset. It is about 90% of the data. And the data in red is the one generated by the user, by the second user, and it counts for the 10% remaining data points. So what we're going to do here is that we're going to perturb the red data set and see how the solution for both ordinarily square and its superquantile counterpart behave. So here is the perturbation in question. And let's see how it goes. All right, so here is what happened for different levels of conformity theta. We observe that when theta is close to one, the expectation loss and the superquantile loss output the same model. It is still the case when theta is close to is equal to 0.5, but when the conformity levels drops to 0.1, the two models we get are quite different. While the solution of the expectation loss tends to follow the trend imposed by the predominant blue points, the solution of superquantile loss takes actually more into account the red points. And that's actually what we want. Here, the red points should not be considered as outliers, but rather as valuable information brought by a device that actually does not conform to the trend imposed by the predominant device. We are not doing robust statistics, we are doing robust optimization. And the last comment I want to have on this problem is that I call it a centralized problem because all the data is gathered at one place. And when running these two problems here, we don't know what data point belongs to which user. We are using the superquantile at a data level without this prior information. This is quite different in the federated setting, where actually the data is split among the users. And what we are going to do in CTSLFL is using the superquantile not at a data level, but at a user level. We do not reweight data points, we reweight distribution of data points. So let us see on a second example that is closer to ours, to our setting, how the superquantile behave in comparison with the expectation. So now our dataset is composed of three Gaussian distributions in R2, with their respective mean here, here, and here. And we associate this distribution to three training devices, and you consider the problem of mean estimation. So the local loss of each device have their local minima exactly at the respective mean of each distribution. And when you are solving fed average on this problem, we are exactly minimizing the average of the three local losses. And we get the average of these three mean, that is the red blue point here, blue square. Sorry. And the blue star here is a solution we obtain when you run simply CLFL with a conformity level 2/3. So on this second plot, we look at distribution of testing users. Since we have three users here, under our assumptions, testing user will have a distribution of data point that can be represented as a convex combination of these three users. So in dark blue here, we have testing distribution for which fed average performs better than simply CLFL. And in yellow, we get testing distribution for which simply CLFL actually performs better. So now when we look in particular to the performance of this whole set of test users, we get the following histogram of testing losses. The histogram is blue, in blue is for fed average, and the histogram in red is for simply CLFL. And what you observe is that actually the performance of fed average are better, in average. And at the opposite, the performance for simply CLFL show a thinner upper tail. That means that simply CLFL, in the worst case, performs quite better than fed average. So we take more into account the devices that were that had poor losses in the fed average setting. All right, so now we can move. So are there any questions at this point?
So it seems there are no questions at this point.
Yeah. Thank you. All right, so now we can move to the proper handling of this optimization framework. All right, so given a model W, we get a distribution of losses over the training devices for this model. By letting each device compute based on their local data distribution, their local loss. And what you propose in our framework is to update only devices with a high enough loss. So formally, we propose the following algorithm. We propose to alternatively minimize the variational formulation of the superquantile given by Terry Rockefeller's property. And we're going to denote this function of both W and eta G. And we propose to solve, to minimize G with an alternating minimization scheme. We solve exactly the minimization of G with respect to eta, since we've seen that it boils down to compute a quantile of the sequence of expected local losses. However, we propose to perform only approximately the minimization with respect to W. And for that, we design a sequence of inexactness criterion, epsilon t, And we are going to ask that epsilon tends to zero in a quite fast manner. In the paper, the minimization step with respect to W is analyzed both when performing it by mini-batch stochastic gradient descent or local SG. So all in all, the algorithm consists in two loops. First, the outer loops here over T, which consists in alternating minimization of G, and the second inner loop required to achieve epsilon accuracy for the minimization with respect to W. So the minimization of this function with respect to W is not straightforward. And the first challenge that we have to tackle is the non-smoothness of the objective that is brought by the max term here. So what you propose is to smooth this max term by taking its Moore envelope, which smoothly approximates the max function. So that overall, assuming that the local losses Fi are smooth, we get a smooth counterpart of the superquantile loss. Actually, we consider the following smooth regularized problem. And we denote g tilde of w and eta, the whole regularized function. And what we can show is that again, as it was the case for the variational formulation here, the partial minimization of g tilde with respect to eta boils down to the computation of the quantile of the sequence of loss Fi. So in the complex setting, we get the following convergence rate results. We assume here that we run local SGD for the inner loop, that is the partial minimization of G tilde with respect to W. And our result consists basically in merging an analysis of first the outer loop of the algorithm for the alternating minimization, and second, the number of gradient calls for local SGD in the inner loop to achieve epsilon t accuracy. And basically for that part, we plug the recent analysis of local SGD published by Anastasia Koloskova and her co-authors. So at the end of the day, to get epsilon accuracy for objective, we show that we need at most t number of communication rounds, where t is the upper bound of this rate. Here, kappa is a conditioning number that depends on the constant b and l and lambda and the smoothing parameter nu, as well as the conformity level theta. So in practice, here is what we do. We still assume that each device I has its own distribution and that it is able, given a model W, to evaluate the loss Fi based on its local dataset. So a first round of communication for simplicial FL starts as fed average. We send the server model to a fleet of selected devices. But then, before running local updates, we are going to ask each selected device to compute its local loss Fi. And we are going to sort the Fi with respect to the 1 minus theta quantile of this sequence of local losses. Then, only devices with a high enough loss will run local SGD. And once this is complete, we perform a secure aggregation of the updated models. All right. So one practical question is how should we fix the level of conformity theta? First, one could argue that fixing theta is more a question of policy. If you fix theta to 0.2, you actually want to focus on the 20% of the least conforming users. If you fix it to 0.1, you're actually looking at the 10% worst case users. So it's up to the proportion of least conforming users you want to focus on. Second, once you fix theta, the model that you obtain and which adapts to the least conforming devices might be quite suboptimal for testing device that actually conforms well to the trend distribution. So the question of balancing between a learning model for the trend distribution and for the least conforming user is really practical. And what could, for instance, perform for that what is called CVAR optimization? It consists in minimizing a convex combination of fed average objective and the superquantile objective. But here we would need also to tune both the convex parameter lambda and the conformity level theta. So what we propose instead is to learn several models at the same time with different levels of conformity. That way, we test devices will be able to take the model that better conform to them, that they better conform to. So. And the second problem is that the minimization over eta of our function g consists in computing the 1 minus theta quantile of the distribution of losses over the training clients. And sending directly the loss of the selected devices to the server might be non-privacy preserving, since we could get to know, roughly speaking, the performance of each of these devices for the given problem. So what we propose instead is a computation of the quantile with a standard majorization minimization scheme. This scheme is particularly known for the case when we need to compute the median of a sequence of values. In our case, our sequence of values is a sequence of local losses evaluated at the current model W. And we want to compute the 1 minus theta quantile of this sequence, that is the median. And in this case, the majorization minimization principle we propose boils down to an iterated least squares procedure, reweighted least squares procedure. It consists in iteratively solving a least square problem as long as eta is different from any of the local losses. And this algorithm is proved to converge to the median of the sequence of local losses. And solving each iteration boils down to the computation of a weighted average of this, boils down to the minimization of this quadratic function. And this can be performed by only averaging terms and multiplying these terms by scalars. So this can be performed in a privacy-preserving manner. And we can actually do this for any conformity level between 0 and 1. We get this quantile by minimizing iteratively a quadratic function. In practice, eta will require 10 to 50 communication. Computing eta will require 10 to 50 communication with the server for the real dataset that we are going to consider. All right, so now I can, maybe there are questions at this point. Yeah, so I will. I'm gonna present the numerical experiment.
I would have one question. Yeah, just to make sure. So with this algorithm that you presented as the last one, you are able to do like everything with like you don't need to keep like a stated clients, right? You can do it with staleness clients, if I'm not mistaken, right?
Yeah.
Okay. Thank you.
Sure. Let's look at our numerical experiments. All right, so we tried our framework on three data sets that are made available through the benchmark LIF. The first data set consists in a sequence of image of handwritten digits and characters, and the task is to recognize the digit or character. The images are grouped by writers, and we kept from these data sets around 1,700 writers and the median number of images per device is about 180. The second dataset is a dataset of tweets that is split among accounts, and the task is to perform sentiment analysis with a binary classification. For this dataset, we kept 877 accounts, and the number of tweets per account is almost 70. And the final dataset is to complete design, the complete design of Shakespeare. And the goal is to perform character level language modeling. So for the first two datasets, we trained both a logistic regression and a neural network model. And we also trained a neural network model for the Shakespeare datasets. In our paper, we specify the architecture of each model and the way we tune the constants, like the regression parameter for the linear model or the step sizes. All right, so to assess the performance of our models, we recorded at each round of communication the local loss of each training device and the test misclassification of each testing device. And here I'm going to focus on the distribution of misclassification errors on testing devices. So in our experiments, we present both the complete distribution as well as some metrics such as the tenth percentile of distribution, the 50th percentile, the 90th percentile, the mean, or the standard deviation. All right, so here we plot the final distribution of misclassification error over device for both fed average in blue and simply cell FL in red. So what you observe is that for any of these three data sets, simply cell FL presents a thinner lower and upper tails than fed average. And this is particularly striking for the MNIST dataset. Our goal was to improve performance on the worst case users, that is the upper tail of the distribution, and we achieved it. This dashed line here symbolizes the 90th percentile of the distribution for both fed average in blue and simply cell FL in red. And we get quite a strong improvement for both the, for at least the first two datasets. However, this comes with a price of lower performance of better conforming models, better conforming devices on the left part of the histograms. So here, the vertical lines with star-shaped markers symbolize the 10th percentile of the distribution for both framework. And fed average performs a little bit better than simply cell FL. So in these scatter plots, we show the performance of both fed average and simply cell FL against a number of local data points. And it is for the MNIST dataset. So what you observe is that the performance of fed average are mainly harmed by devices with smaller local data points. This can possibly be due to the choice of the weights alpha that we made. For the experiments, we took alpha I for the device I that is proportional to its number of local data points. So the objective of fed average might have not been that much focused on this class of devices. At the contrary, it appears that in simply cell FL perform much better, that simply cell FL perform much better on this portion of devices. And this might be explained by the fact that because of the device filtering step in our framework, a more important focus might be given to devices with high losses. These devices were the one with small local data points, so they were more used to update our model in our framework. All right, so there are actually other recent methods that are aimed at handling device heterogeneity. A first class of method is aimed at establishing, or improving the convergence properties of fed average by basically correcting the local drift made by device during the local stochastic gradient descent. We can think of scaffold or fed procs, which were both presented in this seminar. And the second class of method consists in, as our framework does, modifying the average of fed average by another functional. Among these methods, we have QFFL and IFL. So we propose in the experimental section of our paper to compare also with some of these methods, including fed procs, QFFL, and IFL. All right. So on this table, we have the performance of both these four four methods and simply cell FL with varying conformity levels. Here we tune the parameter Q in the objective of QFFL on a grid search and took the best one. So what we observe is that when we look at the 90th percentile of the distribution of misclassification error on the test devices, simply cell FL in the most case outperformed the other approaches for this metric. And this is with quite striking results on the MNIST dataset, both for the linear model and for the neural network architecture. And for the average over this distribution of test misclassification error, simply cell FL is not always the best method to perform, but it's still competitive, in particular for the MNIST dataset in the non-convex case, and SEN140 for the linear model. All right, so finally, we look again at the final performance of testing device against the local data size. And what you observe is that QFFL and fed procs are still it's still hard for them to manage to better handle devices with local with small local data size, whereas in our framework we manage to get better performances. So as a conclusion, we propose a new framework for statistical heterogeneity in federated learning that is really focusing on the least conforming users. And we analyze the associated optimization algorithm, both from a theoretical perspective, and we propose the practical implementation of it. Our numerical experiments show evidence that this framework improves performance for non-conforming users. And there are still open questions for this framework, such as the analysis, for instance, in the non-convex setting that we're working on. Thank you for your attention.
Thank you, Yassin, for your very clear and great talk. Are there any questions? We are still very good on time. So if there are any questions or comments, please either raise your hand or post your question to the chat. So I would start with one question. You said that because you don't know this data like a hat, you might wish to train like more models at once, right?
Yep.
Yeah, so is there actually like, can you actually kind of have a speed up training like more models at once? Like, can you kind of use some computation in like multiple models or stuff like that?
So what I would do is that I wouldn't ask, given one communication round of SimpliSLFL to a given device to update this model for several level of conformity, but both do this in a parallel way.
Yeah, but you cannot kind of use the same computation for multiple models. This has to be kind of separate.
This has to be kind of separate, okay, because we evaluate basically the model at different, this function at different models, you know.
Yeah, so different, I was just wondering that maybe that, yeah, there might be something that you can just, okay, like save some communication.
But that's a good question, yeah, because yeah, as the number of models you are updating grows, this tends to be much more costly.
Yeah, and one more question. Yeah, do I get it like correctly that essentially like since you can run everything like your model like in an online fashion that you just pick like several devices, so your loss function can actually be like online optimization. So this capital N can be infinity, right? That would still go through, like theoretically or not?
Actually, I don't know. Yeah, I'm gonna, okay, I'm gonna say that's a good question.
Because like you can run it, right? Because you have this just sample and client, like just sample some subset of clients, and you can run your algorithm on that.
Sorry, actually, yeah.
So I suppose it should also go through the theory.
I mean, yeah, the objects are well defined when you increase the number of devices, for sure. And we can like precisely define the assumptions that we need, I define the conformity only for a finite number of devices, but you can still do the same with an infinite number of devices.
Okay, so I would add, one more question. For your theoretical, for your experimental results, there was one experiment where actually like fed average performed like the best. So do you have any intuition why that's the best algorithm, like for this 90% quantile? Because like the other algorithms, at least like this QFFL and your algorithms, they optimize to be better in like say 19th percentile. And I think this is not the one. There was also one where like fed up. Yeah, this one. Yeah.
Yeah. It was for the average.
Okay. Sorry. I missed it. So sorry for that.
So yeah, fed procs also performs well on this average. But for Shakespeare, we observed that, I mean, given our experiments, fed average was outputting the best solution.
Yeah, but here it's because that's the objective they optimize, right?
Exactly. Yeah, exactly. Yeah. So you're quite surprised that SimpliSLFL would perform better, at least for the neural network model, but it appeared to happen. Yeah.
So it can be, it can be seen as an also not only as like being good on quantas, but you can also see that as a regularization technique, right?
Exactly.
That might be.
Okay. Yeah, I mean, especially, I mean, if you like try to then to do like mean sever optimization, that's what's like this this super quantile term should can be seen also as a regularization technique.
Yeah. Yeah, thank you. So any other questions, comments? Okay, so I guess it's, there is one. Let me just unmute Ahmed.
Yeah, hi, thanks for the presentation.
Yeah.
I would like to ask about the practical limitation of this technique. You said you need to collect the loss from the clients. Is there any other information that you need to collect?
So actually, even the loss, we don't. We can like solve this. Like perform this iterated related least square procedure to compute the quantile of the loss without sending directly the loss. That's okay. The point. We can still preserve privacy of the users because here, to perform this algorithm, we would need only like averages and multiplication by scalar, and that can be done in a privacy preserving manner.
I see. But would that introduce extra computational cost on the users?
So we did some experiment on that. So like for our data sets, for the few data sets, we didn't have more than 50 iteration of this iterated reweighted least square algorithm to get the right set of devices to update. So, and the thing is that we only have to send so not exactly the loss, but something like a scalar at the end of the day. So it's much less costly than sending the model in the gradient state.
I see. Thanks.
Sure.